things to do in Portland when you're alive and wishing to become even more so. Outlook Portland today welcomes Marc Acito to the program right here on Northwest 32. Hi, I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32. What if you were told that you had to try one thing every day, but something you had never done before? Like try the piccolo, perhaps, or maybe work on a cure for Ebola. Eat a pound of Cheese Whiz. Those are all things you'd do if you were me. If you were somebody more interesting, say Marc Acito, you might do things that were more interesting, and you'd do one of them every single day for 365 days in a year, and then you would discuss how it made you feel, what you learned, and what kind of person you were at the end.
If I can just clarify, it was actually 366.
Because was it a leap year?
Leap year, 2008.
All right, duly noted.
Yes.
We'll fix that later.
Okay.
So you have been on the program before. This is actually your second visit here, at least in this evolution of this fine television show.
Thank you for having me back. And, well, you have excellent taste.
It was all because of the snakeskin shoes that you wore last time. And I ran down a laundry list at the beginning, and I think I had to clarify it later because I left off playwright. I had novelist, humorist, playwright, columnist, mm-hmm. opera singer, compulsive entertainer, and I think raconteur at the end. And has anything changed since then? Have you added maybe sculptor, painter?
No, but I have actually, I'm just going to start doing a column for walletpop.com, which is the finance site for AOL. Because I'm such a well-known economist,
of course.
They asked me to speak about finance. I'm not quite sure why.
Really, let's be honest. I mean, I'm sure that you really are gifted in terms of fiscal responsibility and frugality, but almost anyone right now would probably be better than the group that seems to be running things.
Yeah, okay. So I'm happy for the gig. It's, you know, it's a job.
Actually, before we begin, I should reveal that you and I, and this is a sentence that I never in my wildest imaginings thought that I would say out loud. So, you and I were at Mary's Club recently.
Right. And what's more, backup singers, which is even stranger.
Backup singers at Mary's Club in downtown Portland, shooting part of the video anyway, for Storm Large's new music video, the title of which is not appropriate to say on the air at this time.
Okay.
But I will say
but
that
But you and
was,
I get to sing it.
And it was kind of a microcosm of Portland in a lot of ways because there is myself, you're there, Storm is there just sort of observing. Mm-hmm. There's James Westby, who's been on the show.
And right, the director.
Directing
right.
And sort of overseeing the entire operation. Writer Byron Beck is there. Davey Nipples from Storm and the Balls,
right.
From the band, and Storm's a significant other is there.
And two very talented strippers, as it turns out.
It was... And if I hadn't seen the photographic evidence after the fact, I would have thought it was some bizarre Fellini-esque Busby Berkeley fever dream
mm-hmm.
that I had.
Yeah, right.
And it drove home something that I have heard mentioned by a lot of entertainers and a lot of people who've come here from different cities, which is that in Portland there is very much an artistic community, not just a city full of people who are doing stuff,
mm-hmm.
but an artistic community. And that day, for example, a lot of people coming together to do something for the love of the game.
Right.
As opposed to a city certainly like Los Angeles, where it's much more cutthroat and it's much more of a what are you going to do for me in exchange for this. And have you found that to be the case as you've come from one city?
Oh, absolutely. No, I think Portland is very much that way. I think it's because a lot of us are people who went to those major markets and weren't satisfied in them. They didn't feel right to us. Or, to be honest, we couldn't compete in those markets. And I hear that story a lot. Just yesterday, I was... talking to a designer who was making actually a dress for the Red Dress Party, which is, you know, this big charity fundraiser, which again is one of these strange, organic, very Portland kinds of things. That started as a house party. There were, you know, 50 of us in a basement, and now it's 2,000 people in a warehouse. And this designer, same thing, went to New York, didn't quite work out, came back to Portland to sort of lick his wounds and develop as an artist, and I hear that story all the time. Yeah, I went to LA for a little while and it just wasn't right for me. I didn't like the blah, 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 blah. And then suddenly they're here. And I think maybe we're just more oriented towards being more communal, being more thoughtful of each other's growth. I think it's a very artistic
city.
Was
it a culture shock to come here from some of those other very
Well, in my case, it was from New York. Yeah, I came from the East Coast. Yeah, it was because the people were so nice. I mean, here's a perfect example. You're right about this, and I never thought about it. But one of the very first experiences I had here in Portland, I'm in the grocery store, and I didn't know where something was, and I turned to the woman next to me in the aisle, and I said, "Hey, do you know where thus and such is?" And she says, "Sure." She takes me by the hand, and she abandons her own cart. And walks me
to take
me to that item. She doesn't work there. This is just some random person shopping in the store. And it struck me that was a very Portland kind of thing, because that sort of thing happened over and over again. And it really struck me, you know, coming from New York, I mean,
right.
It's just that's unimaginable that somebody would, you know, they might turn around and
shoot you in the face.
Exactly, yeah. You know, hit you with a hypodermic needle or something like that, and then steal your money. So I think that permeates to the artistic community. I don't think it's unique to the artistic community, though. I think it's a Portland thing.
You think it is something in the culture, in the fabric of the city.
The other thing is that, and this is something that people do, not just lifelong Portlanders, but it's just a habit that we get into. We also give directions based on where things used to be. Have you noticed that?
Yeah, the old Jensen place down the road is not there anymore. There's a fruit stand.
Right. And no one will tell you that. They'll just say, you turn left at where the Fred Meyer used to be. It's like, okay, this is not helping me because I don't know where that Fred Meyer used to be because there is no longer a Fred Meyer. It's something else, and they don't know what that is nor the name of the street.
So we'll move forward in the next segment, I think, to talk about how you were doing sort of a thing every day. But somebody told me maybe I'm remembering the story incorrectly, that Storm was actually the one who suggested in a roundabout way that you do this a different thing every day? Or
no.
Have I heard that incorrectly?
Yeah, you did hear that incorrectly. You should really work on getting those facts right, actually. So
I'll put that right underneath pickup dry cleaning. Facts necessary.
No, it was Storm. No, to be honest, Storm really was the muse for this project. And it happened completely organically. I decided I wanted to do this project, and she happened to be invited for dinner for the very first time. She'd never been to my house before, the very first night that I started this project.
I'm actually, as they say, I'm going to put a pin in this for just one moment,
yes.
And we will come back and resume this on the other side.
Yeah, because you want to hear what happened when Storm Large came to my house.
Otherwise,
I'm telling you.
I'm just going to come and rush the stage. We'll be back. It's Outlook Portland on Northwest 32.